I remember a long time ago, I don't really know how long ago it was, I would venture to say, let's see, probably about 35 years ago, when I was in my 20s, and I had a job, I had two jobs, and I worked two jobs for a long time, and this was a part-time job at night, and I was coming home from that job in my 69 Ford pickup truck with the 3-speed on the column. Has a good old good truck, two-tone, little red and white on the sides and everything, and a little gun rack on the back windshield that we didn't put guns in. We put various sticks and stuff like that. You know, most of you guys know what I'm talking about. But I remember coming home from that job that particular evening, and I was not saved. I didn't get saved until sometime after that, probably about 4, 5, 6 years after that. But I remember coming off an interstate, and I shared this story on a Wednesday night, and I think it fits here, or I wouldn't share it. And this is certainly not to try to glamorize the old life, and I don't want to do that. And I want to just give that disclaimer before you think that I am. But I remember coming off, they called it the Beltway that went around Baltimore. It was called, I think it's 695. Went all the way around the whole entire city, and obviously, you know, there's various places to get off, and then I forget the exit. I think it was exit 15 that I was getting off that particular evening, about 10:15. That store that I worked at closed at about 10 o'clock, and I remember coming off that off ramp, and I was doing something that what I would call trying to take the edge off, and in form of some kind of a smoke device. And so I dropped that particular thing on the floor of my truck when I was coming off of that ramp. And so the priority prior to that was participating in that, and then the priority became getting it off the floor so I could continue to participate in that. And as I was just coming off of that ramp, I had dropped it. It fell in my lap and then it fell on the floor. And so I kind of held on to the steering wheel, and I was going down and down and down and putting my hand down further, and you know, we got a 911 here. We can't lose that. And so I was, you know, kept on feeling, and I just, got it. And now, for you that just went through that in your head, I'm sorry. But I picked it up, my head was, by that time, it was below the dashboard. And then I kind of pulled myself back up, and when I was pulling myself back up, I was on that off-ramp, and that particular off-ramp had a direction to go to the left and had a direction to go to the right. And both of those directions were curved. In other words, both the sides of the street, so there wasn't a shoulder of the road or anything like that. And as I was, and my direction was to go to the left, and that's where I was headed prior to going down to the floor. When I came back up, I was going past, at the very time that I came back up, I was between the curve to my left and a car that had been broken down, or it was actually another pickup truck that had been broken down on the right part of that lane. That no doubt, I didn't do the measurements or anything like that, there couldn't have been a half a foot from me to the curb, and there couldn't have been a half a foot between me and that truck. And as I was coming up, and the off ramp is about 45 miles an hour, so you know, you don't have to be a genius to figure out, if I'd have hit that parked vehicle at 45 miles an hour with my head underneath the dashboard, it would probably kill me. And so I came back up, and as I was going past it, obviously it was just like something like that, and then I went past it, and I caught my breath, if I had any left, and then there probably wasn't 30 or 45 seconds, maybe 1 minute, to where I just went on with my business. And sick as that sounds, you know, I'm not trying to describe anything that perhaps anything similar that may have happened to you or may not have happened to you, but you know, when I look back at that situation, I wish I could say, and there's other situations that are similar to that, that I wish I could say that's what God used to stop me. But I can say that's what God was trying to use to stop me. And in spite of my foolishness, and in spite of coming off of that experience, and in no exaggeration, 1 minute later, right back into what I had dropped on the floor. And then I had what I thought was some kind of a cool story, you know, to tell people, you know, when I was lost and when they were lost. And unfortunately, disgustingly, you know, kind of joking about it, and wow, that's crazy and all that. And then, you know, while you're telling the story, you're doing the same thing. And when I look back at that, among other things that I could think of and learn from, one thing that strikes me as, you know, in the forefront of my mind every time I think about that situation and others is the grace of God, the patience of God, the mercy of God, the compassion of God, the love of God, and the protection of God.
Amen.
You know, and when I say the protection of God, I say the protection of God, and certainly that's a pretty good example. We don't need any more detail based on that story. When I say the protection of God on stories like that, concerning stories like that, I say the protection of God in spite of us, not because of us. I wasn't trying to protect myself that night. I didn't have a seatbelt on. It wasn't anything. It was throw caution to the wind and, you know, do what you're going to do and live like you're going to live. And in spite of that, God looks down, and I'm sure there's more than one story in here besides that one, where God looks down and says, no, I see something ahead of this that's a lot better than this. And I want to keep them around for a while for whatever reason, you know, so he can see how I am and who I am and what I am, and he can experience that so he doesn't have to do what he's doing on the off ramp. And so I said that to say this is, you know, when we look at this part three, this new protection that we have, you know, I'm not saying in the old life we didn't have protection, because we couldn't have got to the new life if we didn't have in the old life.
Right.
It's absolutely amazing. It's mind-boggling to me what God has, and I think I can speak for most of the room, if not the whole room, what God has brought us through to get us to today.
Amen.
And if he has, and you recognize that, certainly I hope that you're not, but if you are, try to discipline yourself not to take that for granted and see that that's the activity of God in your life and my life for a greater purpose. You know, he uses those situations not so then, you know, back then when that all happened and soon after that happened, you know, it was kind of sitting around a table and joking about it. Now it's to sit around a table and learn about it and sit around a table and avoid it and sit around a table and learn from it. And so I don't have to go back. I can go back to that off ramp again, but I don't have to ever participate in what I was participating in when I went off at that one time. You know, and there's a bunch of ramps in life. You get off, you get on. And if you've gotten on this one, if I can respectfully say the Jesus ramp, don't get off it.
Amen.
Don't get off it. You know, you might not have 6 inches on the truck, between you and the truck on the right of you. So when we look at this lesson, we're going to learn about it. And we're going to learn about it in two ways to look at it. And there's obviously more ways to look at it. But we're going to look at it primarily in two ways. And the two ways that we're going to look at God's protection, or this new protection, is God's protection or God's responsibility for my protection, and then what is my responsibility? Because if you hadn't figured it out, we do have responsibility. In other words, I can take myself out of the protective hand of God. That does not necessarily mean I take myself out of the grace of God, out of my relationship with God, but I can, if I'm not careful, I can get to the place in my life where God says, okay, you know, if that's what you want to do, go ahead and do it. And most of us have figured out when we've done that, I don't know if I'm the only person in the room that's ever been like that, but when we've done that, that we've learned that there is a better way to live. And that way to live is to live under the protection, the protective hand of God when we're doing our part as far as God's protection. Look at the verse at the top of the page. We're going to look a little bit more in depth at that verse in a couple of minutes. Isaiah chapter 41 in verse 10, where Isaiah says, now this is Isaiah speaking as a prophet. And somebody, that thermostat, the fan, is anybody getting a little cold already?
Yes.
Okay. The fan is on. I can detect, especially in my wife's life, when she is uncomfortable. Are you uncomfortable, Vic? She's not even listening. She's,
I'm good.
I already taught her this whole lesson last night, so she didn't have to pay attention. But I know. But if someone will go up that knows how to work that thing, just, it's on. The fan is on. Just hit the fan and make it go on auto, and then it'll go off. By the time we get out of the building. Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 10. And as I said, Isaiah the prophet, an Old Testament prophet, if you did not know, and many of you do know, an Old Testament prophet spoke on behalf of God. And so you'll see many times in the book of Isaiah, in the book of Jeremiah, the minor prophets and the major prophets, when we describe it minor and major, it's just the length of their writing. So it's not like a major prophet had a higher level of importance as to what he said. or did not say, as far as, and one we would describe as a minor prophet, who just the length of their writing was either long or short. And Isaiah spoke on behalf of the Lord, and he said this, God said, fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Now, I don't know how many of you are memorizing scripture, and I'm sure there's more than a handful of you that are, but I'm going to tell you what, you can't go wrong, and you are doing yourself, we are doing ourselves a disservice in our relationship with God and the effectiveness of that relationship personally, in our lives personally, by not memorizing the Word of God. You say, Rick, I can't do that. And I'm not here to talk about scripture memory, but I guess I am, okay? But I want to tell you this. Get the Word of God in you, and you will be absolutely amazed. Perhaps it's not as amazing as we might think it should be, but I'm going to tell you what. If you get the Word of God in you by way of memorization, God will do what Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would do, bring things to your remembrance. And when he was referring to those things that he would bring to our remembrance, the Holy Spirit, that is, it's things that we have learned, things that we have been taught. And God will bring those up at the best time, at the most useful time, and sometimes at the urgent time. And this is one of those verses I would highly recommend. You do it, if, you know, I mean, you're not going to get... You know, you're not going to get extra cheese if you do it for me, but I'm just saying, I would highly recommend that you memorize this verse. It is an amazing verse, as all of them are, but it's an amazing verse that speaks personally to this idea of protection when you don't listen, when you don't necessarily feel protected. Okay, and I'm not talking about when your life is perhaps in physical danger. I'm just talking about you need a word from God. This is a great word from the Lord. So read along. What a blessing it is to know that when we become God's child, we have the protection of God placed over our lives. The word protection means the act of protecting or the state of being protected, preservation from injury or harm. If you have become a child of God by placing your trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior and asking Him to forgive you of your sins, invited Him into your heart, you have been placed in the protective hand of God. This protection, as we will learn, does not mean, there's the emphasis, does not mean that we will not experience difficulty, heartache, and pain in this life. However, we do know that we can overcome and walk in victory over despair and hopelessness when dealing with the struggles and challenges of life. So don't think, if the skeptic comes to say to us, well, why does this happen, and you're supposedly being protected by God? Some of the answers to those questions are this, I don't know. And in due time, and it may not be till we get to heaven, will we know some of the answers to those questions. So I don't know why, for example, bad things happen to good people. But if you stick around long enough in this life, and God keeps us around long enough in this life, I have noticed, and I've personally noticed in my life, when bad things do happen, that we would have never wanted to happen. We would have never asked to happen. And thank God, sooner or later, we didn't even cause it to happen. And those things happen in our lives. As time goes on, if time does in fact go on, you'll see little bits and pieces as it goes on. Okay, maybe this is how, you know, this is what God's showing me based on this situation that was not a good situation that I never would have asked for, and God's teaching me something through it. He's helping me through it. And by the way, this area of life speaks to that in a big way. In a big way. I've met many people who have, out of their adversity, found their purpose for life in the Christian life based on what they wish would have never happened in their life. And so that can just be a small part of it. All of us would admit that for some, that in some form, and now that, okay, let me explain this, okay? You got a 51-22 right there? That's the first time that's happened in a really long time. So now you're gonna learn some technology, okay? When I go to print these things, it asks for a code. Okay, and when I don't click on the little box that's asking for the code, it writes the code wherever the cursor is in the document. So what's my code? 5122. Okay, now the secret's out. You can punch that code anywhere and go to any ATM and get absolutely nothing. Okay, all right. So all of us would admit in some form or another, forget the 5122, we have the need to feel protected. We lock our doors, wear seatbelts, wash our hands, at least we should, eat things that we believe will help us to stay healthy, take vitamins, and avoid placing ourselves in dangerous situations. We can make the list of things we believe will give us a sense of feeling protected very lengthy. But when many of us look back in the past for the sake of learning how we might better our future, we would admit that what we might have done and where we may have been have been anything but placing ourselves in the protective environments in situations. The Bible warns us concerning the deceitfulness of sin. We learn what the Apostle Paul said in a previous lesson in Romans chapter 7 and verse 11, for sin, taking occasion by the commandment, did what? Deceived me, and by it slew me. We learn from Paul's letter to Timothy in the days preceding to the second coming of Jesus Christ that there will be greater deception. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 13, Paul writes to Timothy as a warning, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. That's obviously going on today. It's been going on since Paul gave Timothy that instruction or that warning. There's a verse of Scripture that adequately describes many of our lives before Christ, found in the book of Titus, and we read this every single Wednesday night. Titus chapter 3 and verse 3, for we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, what? Deceived, serving diverse, that word diverse means various, lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. I know that that's not the description of anybody in the room, but there were people like that, okay? All right? I need only to look at the magnitude of deception in my own life before I met Jesus. I do not understand the level of deception that would surpass the ability to see the imminent danger and sometimes even death were at arm's length on hundreds of occasions, but sadly, I've experienced it. With the absence of God's Holy Spirit to convict me, there was no protection but the protection of human reasoning, of which I ignored and later destroyed with drugs and alcohol and a despicable appetite to get what I wanted. I grew up with most of the things that we mentioned that help us to feel protected, but my need for protection had grown far greater than it had ever been before. It became a matter of life and death, but also had a greater need to be protected from what I had become, my own worst enemy. You ever thought about that? I'm not trying to paint the same picture of everybody else, but the protection really wasn't to be protected from what was going on around me. My protection needed to be protected from what was going on in me. I don't care where you go, you can't get away from you. And if you try that, go ahead and give it a shot. Run around the building for a while. But, the bottom line, you can't get away from your own, if you are participating in that foolish thinking. You can't do that. And to the person, no disrespect to the person that's not saved, but really human reasoning, when you think about it and you line it up with reality, on some occasions, is almost in an understatement to say it's absolutely ridiculous. What I would describe or what I would think was trying, what I was thinking was helping me or useful to me, was actually doing the opposite. It was not helping me and it was hurting me. That was, again, in all due respect, that was human reasoning. You know, when a person gets saved, doesn't make us any better than anybody that hadn't been saved, but now you have the ability, because of your relationship with the Lord, to see things the way that they really are. That's called discernment. And listen, and I've said this probably hundreds of times over the last 12 years in most excellent way. If you're praying for anything, you ought to be praying every single day. Don't do it because I said to do it. I'm just saying, take this advice. Wisdom what? Wisdom and discernment. Pray for that every single day. Why? Because you need that. Any man that lacketh wisdom, James said, let him ask of God, who will give it to you. And we need wisdom. What is wisdom? As you grow in your relationship with the Lord, and as you learn more about that relationship based on His Word, wisdom will do for you what it does for anybody else. Well, it will enable you to practically and consistently apply what God's teaching you. In other words, you're not just a head full of facts. Although that's good, and to get that knowledge, but God wants you to make that knowledge useful and practical. And so the wisdom that you and I need is when we learn God in the activity of our lives, throughout our daily lives, day by day, God gives us an opportunity and brings those things up that we learn so we can apply it. For example, the way that we talk and when we shouldn't talk. Just something that practical. Have you ever noticed? And if you hadn't noticed by now, you need to start asking for wisdom, okay? Okay? You've heard phrases like this, and it's true. It's not always what you say, it's how you say it. You know, and that speaks so clearly to areas of the Christian life when it comes to communication. That's why we have, unfortunately, our society has dumbed down communication to text messaging. Yeah. I have found myself in more pickles from time to time over a text message because the person took it the wrong way because they're just reading it and it doesn't have any necessarily emotion to it, or they don't see your motive and they read into it. Well, it doesn't mean that you're going to get the wisdom to look at your phone and go, I know exactly what you're saying right now because I'm a wisdom-filled Christian right now. No, that doesn't always mean that. But I can tell you what, sometimes you get the wisdom by God, if you're asking for it, when it comes to communication, to not say anything at all. Amen. That's an interesting concept, isn't it? Just don't say anything. And how many times, and I hope that we're getting to this place, how many times have you been in a conversation or you are listening to a conversation, not just eavesdropping, and you're like, you want to say something, and the Holy Spirit of God's going, hush up. Now, the Holy Spirit doesn't say shut up. He says hush up, okay? But, you know, I mean, like, what is that? That's the leadership of the Holy Spirit of God. What does that speak to? That speaks to your Christian growth, you know? Or that when you say it, you know, a good word in season, the Bible talks about. You say it in a timely way, and you say it in an effective way. And so that's just one of the areas in the Christian life that speak to the fact that when you didn't have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit prior to getting saved, you're just kind of left to yourself. You're kind of left to yourself. And if you are a Christian and you do have, and by the way, if you aren't a Christian, you don't have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, but because you do, let Him lead that. Let Him guide you. And as you see that, then you can make decisions moment by moment. Sometimes it is moment by moment and day by day, and just leave those decisions up to God and let Him lead you based on that. And that's how we stay in that protection. Praise God. Listen, for the verse that follows in the book of Titus, and at first glance, those first three amazing words, but after that. Now remember the first part of it. At some time we were foolish, deceived, having various diverse... what is it? Lust. We at some one time were also foolish, deceived. Passions and pleasures, various. That's good. I'm definitely just a test. I knew exactly what it was. Okay, but look at verse four through seven. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done. In other words, you can't earn it. You can't do anything to get it. You can't, you know, like do a bunch of good deeds and then your good deeds are gonna outweigh your bad. I'd have to live 150 years for that. But according to His mercy, He did what? He saved us by the washing of regeneration, the renewing of the Holy Spirit, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. That being justified by grace, that word justifies, in other words, God looks at you just as if you've never sinned. Obviously, that doesn't mean that you haven't, but that's the righteousness of Christ on you after your salvation experience. We should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Having then the knowledge and privilege of being in Christ, God has now made provision for our protection. We will look at what the Bible teaches concerning God's responsibility, and when we look at what the Bible teaches concerning our responsibility. First, God's responsibility. The value of the promises contained in God's Word, or that should be, and I try to put that R in proper English, is, because it's plural, is for us to adequately describe. For every experience in life, there is a promise or promises from God's Word that will guide us through that experience. However, do not be defeated when you are not seeing your need met, how and when you believe that God should be meeting it. That is when our faith sustains us and keeps us. As we look at some of these promises that pertain to God's responsibilities in terms of His protection for us, we must first and foremost take God at His Word in spite of the way things may seem to appear. Wow, is this an area of life where people get tripped up? And I see it all the time, and I get the phone, and I'm not making light of them, okay? So don't misunderstand that, because I remember this. I remember this, and if I'm not careful, I can still experience this. So it's not like, I remember I used to go through this, I never go through this anymore. Our feelings can really kind of push us off course if we're not careful.
Yeah.
You know, for example, in your prayer life, you know, you pray about something, and it doesn't appear that God's doing anything about what you're praying about. And, you know, you're kind of like frustrated about it because you prayed four times. Seriously? Come on. You know, and it's like, you know, and you know, the Bible talks about asking it shall be given, seeking you shall find, knocking it shall be opened unto you. Well, Jesus was talking about that. He was talking about keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Don't just do this one-time thing and then let it go. I remember one time I participated in an event out on the beach, and it was a weekend event. It was a skimboarding event, and it went to 2 days, and our church participated in the second day, which was a Sunday. And I just said, not being insistent, that if you're going to have this, it was a skimboarding event that what used to be Saturdays, and it got so big they did it on Saturday and Sundays. And so we were participating in just, you know, a little bit of sponsorship and stuff like that, our church was. And I talked to the guy that was overseeing it, and I said, if you're going to do it on Sunday, you're going to carry it on Sunday this year. I said, I think you ought to have church for the people, you know, on Sunday mornings. I mean, you know, you can't make them come, but have it available, because more than likely, out of all these families, about 1,000, 1,500 people were coming to the event. I said, somebody's going to want to go to church, because they go to church, and they might show up. So we had a group of people that came out and did some worship. In fact, I think Matt was part of that. It was a long time ago. I just shared my testimony, just a short message out of the Word of God, if you can believe that, the short part. But and there was a guy that came to that who was the MC of the whole event. You know, he was the guy that was, you know, describing all the moves and stuff like that I know very little about, the skimboarders and stuff like that. His name was Joe Bonk. And Joe came to that little worship service that Sunday morning at about 8 or 9 o'clock when we had it. And he was sitting like right where BJ's sitting. I think he was actually in the front row. And he had a brand spanking new Bible on his lap out of the hotel drawer. You know what I mean? Old Gideon Bible sitting on his lap. I guess he just opened that door. This will do. You know, since I'm going to church. And I thought that was pretty neat. And he was locked in on every word that I said that morning. And it was, again, it was brief. And I just shared how Jesus Christ save my life and save my soul, and share the gospel. And I gave an invitation at the end, and let anybody that wanted to receive Christ in a prayer, and ask, you know, if you prayed that prayer, lift your hand up. I just want to pray for you. And old Joe's hand went. Aww. I mean, it just went straight up. I don't even know if I saw it go up. It was just up. And and at the end, when we got done and everything like that, and getting on with the day, and old Joe couldn't wait, man. He came up to me, and he hugged me. I mean, he just gave me this bear. He was kind of a big guy anyway, but I thought, you know, dude, if I got a pimple on the top of my head, it's gone. You know what I mean? I mean, he hugged me, and he was like, boom! And hugged me, and said, that was awesome. That's the best tool I've ever heard. I'm like, like this. But, and we rejoiced, and I told him, you know, you ought to, when you get back home, because he lived on the East Coast, I said, you need to get in church, man. You need to get baptized. You need to get in the Word of God. Gave him as much as I could. Well, the following Sunday, I came to church, and old Frank Brown, he's in heaven now. He was the original Army Road, Mr. Surfs, Frank and Nadine Brown. And he came up to me, and he shook my hand, and with tears in his eyes, he said to me, he said, Rick, I heard Joe Bonk got saved yesterday at the last week, because it was a previous Sunday. He said, I heard Joe Bonk got saved last Sunday. I said, yes, sir, he did. I said, man, if there ever such thing as he really got saved. And he said, man, that's awesome. And he said this. He said, I've been praying for him for 8 years. And I thought, oh my goodness. Here's a guy that had been praying for somebody's salvation for 8 years, and I spent 20 minutes or 25 minutes. And along the way, and he, you know, and I'm thinking, he's thanking me. And I thought, no. Some plan, some water, but God gives the increase. Now, I'm going to tell you what. I don't know what would have happened if old brother Frank would have gave up on Joe 4 years before that, or 4 months before that, or 4 weeks before that, or 4 days like some of us give up. That's convicting to me personally, and I'm not trying to, you know, just shove my conviction on you, but I know there's a lot of things that I've prayed about 2, 3, 4, 5 days later. It's either I forget, that's not a good excuse, because I ought to write it down if I do forget, or I just stop praying about it. I've seen more happen just because of prayer than probably anything else in my Christian life. And I can tell you one thing that will alleviate the feelings of confusion and frustration is prayer. So why are you telling me that, Rick? Because I'm telling you that because of this. When you look at the situations in life that you can't do anything about yourself, and you're not praying about it, no wonder you're frustrated. No wonder I'm frustrated. And just give it to God, and give it to God, and give it to God. And I will tell you this, and we're going to move on. There's something really special. And I'm not saying nobody likes, like, I love praying and God not doing anything. That's awesome. Well, I tell you what, there's really something special about just giving it to God. Because when you do, He really does do something. What's He do? He takes it from you. And if that ain't enough for now, and listen, that's enough. That's enough. But every once in a while, what do?
Take it back.
Nothing happened. And you're praying for somebody and they're still acting the same. You're praying about something and you still don't have it. Now listen, God's always, listen to this, and if you didn't hear any other part of it, listen to this part. God's always doing something. You just don't know it. And I just don't know it. And if God would just do what we tell Him, He would be the awesome God that we sing about, wouldn't He? No. I'd have a messed up life because I already tried to run my life and it didn't work out too well for me. And thank God I got a do-over, okay? And I'm thankful for that you got one too, okay? What we must always understand is that we are only able to see the here and now, but God is able to see from the beginning to the end. Just know and rest assured that you are always under the watchful eye of God, and all things will work together for good. Let's look at a couple of several areas, and I'm going to just go over these questions, but I really hope that you do just give them some thought in the times that you have outside of this class. That's what they're there for. Let's look at several areas of our lives where the Bible speaks clearly concerning God's protection. One, and this is a biggie. I don't know what you go through. I don't pretend to know, and I don't say things because I think somebody's going through something, but I do know this, that protection from fear is something that most of us, if not all of us, need. Because fear is generated from that frustration. And fear is generated from what we think as. Now, we don't necessarily literally describe it this way, but fear is often birthed in what we think may be hopeless. Or what we may think is not happening. And fear sometimes is a real active ingredient, if you will, in this area of substance abuse and addiction and stuff like that. And I've seen it, I've experienced it on a personal level, and I've watched it so many different times where some people are afraid to get clean because they're scared they can't do it. Because, unfortunately, the enemy somehow has convinced them that if they'll just be able to hold on to something, then they'll be okay. Listen, Satan's real, real subtle and tactical. What do you mean? He has, and I don't want to get into this in detail and blow somebody off course, but he has come up with some things as replacements to addiction that people are addicted to. And I say that respectfully, but I tell you, it's true. It's true. And I'm not saying that, and I'm going to go on record for saying this. I'm not anti-medicine. But I do know this, that if some people, and I would have been one of them if I'd have got the same offer, if some people are told that if you can have this instead of doing that, they'll take this, I would have done the same thing. Why? Because there was this element of fear that I can't stop doing everything. And I'm not talking about prescribed medicine. Please don't misunderstand that. I'm just talking about substituting things, because I did that on my own. I would quit one thing and just keep doing another thing. And typically what people do, what I did, I'm not saying because I did it, but I see it all the time. What people do is they quit, or they try to quit, the thing that's causing the most problems. Well, there's a lot of things that cause the most problems. Like all of it, you know what I mean? But the bottom line is, if I think, I'm like, okay, well, I'm going to slow down on this, and then I'm going to do this. Because I need something to take the edge off. Take the edge off. You ever thought about that? I am the edge, okay? It's not me taking the edge off. It's not that. Listen, if you want some spiritual advice that's very simplistic, Jesus takes the edge off. Amen. He does. He gives you peace. He does. And we need that. especially in these times, and you, and I say respectfully and compassionately, y'all that are coming out of this early, you know, and we give out those tokens all the time, 30 days and 60 days and stuff like that, just hang in there. Hang in there. There is a little tension. There is a little anxiety. And that's very common. So don't get thinking that you're the only person that's going through that. That's very common. Don't let that blow you off a course. Let God, or allow God, to work through that with you. To work through that, you. And we're going to have some answers here in a couple of minutes. The first thing that we see in this promise, you see on the top of page 3, fear not, I am with thee. That was your memory verse, if you choose to memorize it. Fear not, I am with thee. Be not dismayed, I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. The first thing that we see in this promise is the instruction for us to what? To not be afraid. Now, that's God saying that. That is God speaking to you as his child, saying, don't be afraid. Remember when you were a kid, and if you got kids, you do the same thing. And we raised 4 of them. I guess we did. You know, they're adult age, you know, and they're doing good. But I remember fear, and I remember trying to do everything I could possibly do to make sure my kids were not afraid while I'm around. Amen. I mean, that's the instinctive behavior of a dad, or it ought to be. And so if it was a thunderstorm or something like that, then I'm scared, you know. I mean, I didn't go like, it's a thunderstorm. You know how many kids get struck in their bed? Probably not that many. Go to bed. You know what I mean? No. No, it's like, that's okay. It's just a thunderstorm. You know? Don't worry about it. Everything's going to be all right. You know? And so, in other words, we'll do whatever we can to bring down a level of fear in our children. We should. Why don't you think God would do that? You think God's just loving, you know, me being afraid? So he can go, make it depend more on me. No, he don't want me to be afraid. I think it grieves God that I'm afraid, because it's a lack of trust. Yeah. I don't think he likes that I'm afraid. And so the first thing that we see in the promise is for us not to be afraid. Many people feel emotionally crippled when coming out of addiction simply by the fear of the unknown. Often a person experiences this because they're afraid that they might not be able to experience life without their drink or drug of choice. Yes, it is a twisted thought to think that something that might have the possibility to make us worse is somehow sustaining us. But as twisted as it is, these are sometimes very real feelings, and the thought of doing without them can produce great fear. And that's a fact. And I've talked to the people, I've been one of them, and I keep saying that, but it's just true. But I've heard it from other people say, Rick, you don't understand. Man, I need this. Well, there are some things that people need, and I don't get in that area of life, but I do know this. There are other things that people think they need, that they abused. I mean, how can anybody, one, if it's illegal, okay, that's not something I need if it's illegal. God would never leave me to do that to help me. And two, if I'm abusing it, if it is legal, okay? I mean, you got to think practically and logically as well to be protected. Okay, the two reasons that God gives us for not being afraid are that he is with us and that he is our God. Now, this is when you take the Word of God and the promise of the Word of God and you apply personally to your life. This is not some kind of a chant. This is not kind of like a hope so until I know so. But in other words, if we're going to take the Word of God at face value, I have to take the promise of the Word of God, listen, personally. If I'm a saved man, and thank God by the grace of God I am, then I can say with confidence, based on the Word of God, that God is with me. And it's not just, again, it's not just a chant, but you got to remind yourself what the Word of God. I honestly examine myself, what? In the light of God's Word. What will overcome the feeling, most of those feelings that are false, in other words, just based on what ifs in a lot of cases, and I got to take those feelings and I got to apply the Word of God to those feelings. When I'm afraid, I don't feel like God's with me. But does that mean God's not with me? No, because the Word of God tells me that He is. And that He is what? He's my God. It's personal. Because I'm His child. He's my Father. I'm His child. It's personal. So I got to remind myself, listen, not of the feeling that I'm experiencing right now. I got to remind myself of what the Word of God says about me and about God. Amen. As it pertains to me personally. I'm going to tell you what, you get this in you, and that's why this speaks to, you heard the term, meditating on the Word of God. No, it's not sitting Indian styles with some finger symbols and burning incense, okay? Okay? It's not rolling these things around in your mind until sooner or later they click. No, until they click. I got to, day by day, get the Word of God in me so I can apply it to my life. For example, you're feeling some anxiety, and anxiety is real, and I've experienced it. I hope I never appear to be making light of it. I've had anxiety in a very real way, and to the level of anxiety attacks. And I don't mind saying that. I've had them. And they're real. And they're ginormous in some cases. But I do know this, that the Word of God speaks to those things and helps me with those things. And so what do? When I'm going through something, when I'm afraid, when I'm anxious, when I'm scared, however you want to describe it, the Word of God needs to be continually brought up in my mind. Renew your mind, okay? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, when I'm afraid, God, listen, you don't necessarily have to remind God of His Word. He knows His Word. But you're taking and you're praying the Word of God. What am I? I'm fearful. I'm afraid. I'm anxious. I'm nervous. I got this and I got to do that. I'm going to a job interview. I'm going to, my PO. I'm going to doing this and I'm going to doing that. And Satan's telling me the whole time, you're not good enough. You're going to fail. You're going to dive on this. It's not going to work out. What am I going to do? I don't get in a conversation with him. I need to get in a conversation with God. God, your Word says that you're with me all the time.
Amen.
And God, I know because your Word says that you're with me all the time. Listen, you're praying right now that you're with me right now.
Amen.
And the God, that your Word says that you're my God. And your Word says that I'm your child, which means right now, God, you're my God. And right now, God, I'm your child. And you told me to fear not. You told me not to be afraid. And God, let's just be honest with God. And God, I am afraid. Please help me with my fear. What's wrong with being honest with God? Sometimes we pray like we're more spiritual than we are. Anybody ever had that? Listen. God understands when you pray, it's not in King James language, okay? God understands you. It's like, oh, God, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He knows who He's the God of, okay? But I'm just saying, if you're going to get to God, just tell God like it is.
Amen.
Tell God like it is. I'm not saying to be irreverent or anything like that, and I don't think that it's being received that way, but the bottom line is, when you're scared and you got somebody this way around you that'll help you, I bet you don't go, oh, Father BJ of Matt and Emily and all this here. Oh, no. BJ, I need some help right now. Okay, get over here. Yeah. Well, when it comes to God, listen, we don't have to go on down the family line. Okay? God, I need some help. Simon Peter's a good example of that in the Word of God. He's sinking. Okay? He's going down for the count. He looked around at the waves and the water and the wind and everything like that, and he got scared. He was afraid. He didn't go like, Jesus, I think I'm in a little pinch right now. And I remember you telling me, you know, when I'm fixing to drown, do the backstroke or anything like that. And you know what he said? He said three words. Lord, save me. That's a pretty good prayer. That's a pretty good prayer. I think that's a daily prayer. You know what I mean? It might be save me from saying what I want to say. Save me from, you know, I mean, it could be anything. That could apply to every area of life. You know what I mean? But the bottom line is, what happens? We're praying the Word of God. And when we do, listen, we know it's personal, because God's personal. While we should be incredibly encouraged by these two promises, don't overlook the phrase that connects the two. He said, He's with us, and then He's our God. But right between that, the Bible says, don't be dismayed. I love the meaning of this, and especially the application. The word displays means to be dazzled or to be confused. And I know we use dazzled all the time. You know what I mean? I mean, half of the room, when they're coming in, before you got your coffee, some of you did look a little dazzled, okay? Once you got your coffee, you were fine. But we don't think about it on those lines. But you think about this, okay? He says, He's with us. He's our God. Now, why would God tell Isaiah to say to me and you, but don't be confused, if there is not, from time to time, some level of confusion? What's the confusion? It's not the confusion as to whether or not God's our God. I think the confusion lies is, are we just going to take Him up on His promises? And I know that there's a lot in life that gets confusing, isn't there? What do I do? When do I do it? How do I do it? Why should I do it? What should I say? What should I not say? I mean, that's the typical day in the life of the believer. But I'm going to tell you what, God says, I don't want you to be confused. I don't want you to, he's not the author of confusion, by the way. While we should be incredibly encouraged by these two promises, we should not overlook the phrase that connects the two. And that phrase, again, is be not dismayed. The word dismayed means to be dazzled or confused. We can apply this promise by knowing that God is with us, he is our God, and that regardless of how things look, although they might look confusing, he knows, he understands, and he has the power and ability to work all things together for our good. And then bonus right after that. Look what happens. We then see three priceless provisions that we have promised to us by God. He said, he'll strengthen you. Now that sounds like a time other than any other time where we're being strengthened is when we're being confused. But God says, listen, he said, don't be afraid. He said, don't be confused. I'm your God. Now that right there, is this is the way that I could apply this in my own personal life. That right there ought to strengthen me. The reminder, God's, it's almost like as if the verse, and if we allow it, it will, God just bumps things back in. He just makes that adjustment and says, hold on, don't be afraid. Don't be confused. I'm your God. I'm going to strengthen you. And usually in times like this, when we need a promise like this, that's when we need the strength, isn't it? When we're weak, when we can apply this. The word strengthen means to be strong, alert, courageous, brave, bold, solid, and to make one to be determined and alert. Wouldn't you like to walk like that every single day? God said, he'll strengthen you. He said, that's what he'll do. He'll help you. This means that God will not only assist us, but also support us in doing so. And we all need support. He'll uphold us. And this means that God will take hold of us or grasp us or hold on to us. Isn't it absolutely amazing, according to Romans chapter 8, that God, the Bible talks about, he'll never leave us nor forsake us in Hebrews. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 8 that nothing can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. In other words, what's that speak to me about? That I'm not holding on to God. What? God's holding on to me. God's got me. And sometimes it's by the back of my shirt or the back of my neck. He can't get me by my hair, but I'm telling you what, he can do. God can hold on to you. And listen, right now, this second, listen, I hope this encourages you based on the Word of God, not Rick, but out of the Word of God and based on the authority of that Word. God's holding on to you right now. He's holding on to you. That speaks to the grace of God, doesn't it? When I think about that, I think, man, God, that it makes a lot of sense for you to hold on to some other people. Why would you hold on to me? Because I love you. Amen. Because I see, I want to protect you. I want to help you. I want to grow you. I'm holding on to you. And he will never, ever let you go. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. The word forsake has the idea of abandoned. A lot of us can relate to that. I've been left some places. God will never leave me. He'll never do that. Friend, God will strengthen you. God will help you. God will hold on to you. This promise will help us overcome any fear that might rise up and attempt to cause us to give up or to give in. Never allow fear to get the victory over the things that you have struggled with. God is bigger than addiction. The greatest protection that we have to overcome fear is and always will be what? His Word. Next week we're going to look at protection in God's will. I'll take that 51:22 out of there so you won't be confused and play the lottery or something because you saw it on the page. Okay? Don't do that. Don't do that. Let's go ahead and have a word of prayer and we'll go to church. Father God, thank you for the promise of the Word of God in Isaiah 41:10 that you tell us that you'll help us, you'll strengthen us, you'll uphold us. God, thank you that we don't have to be confused. And God, when we are, because we get that way sometimes, help us to hold on to your promises, to know that we're in the protective hand of God, and that we can, as we learn next week, God, we can do our part to make sure that. And Father, I thank you for every person in this room, what you're doing in and through their lives. I thank you, God, for the changes taking place in so many places, in so many areas in this ministry, because of you. Not because of anybody else, but because of you and your word. And I pray in Jesus' name that we will take you at your word. We will apply your word to our lives. God, as we pray your word and we live out your word, that you will help us to be everything that you want us to be, less like we have been, and more equipped and capable of helping somebody else. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.